Kane Brown, Blessed and Free Tour. Saturday, October 23rd, FedEx Forum. Special guests, Jordan Davis and Restless Road. See the meteoric rise of Kane Brown live. Tickets are on sale now at KaneBrownMusic.com. Presented by AEG Presents.
Represent every day. Presented by Delta Dental of Tennessee is an incentive-based program focused on keeping youth K through 6th grade engaged in school in order to combat truancy. In partnership with Shelby County Schools and with the help of Delta Dental of Tennessee, the Grizzlies are focused on reducing chronic absenteeism among the most impacted schools in the Mid-South. Students in the program have the opportunity to win fun and unique prizes by going to school every day and being engaged in the classroom. For more information on the program, visit Grizzlies.com/community/education today.
When you hire Nahon Saharovich and Trotz to handle your serious car or truck wreck case, we get right down to business. By sending out our rapid response team with all the resources to visit the accident scene, talk to witnesses, and consult with the necessary experts. To help you get paid for your injuries, call 683-7000. Hurt in a car or truck wreck? Think fast. Call Team NST today.
Chris Stapleton's All-American Roadshow. Friday, December 3rd at FedEx Forum. With special guests, the Marcus King Band.
You wanna drink of water, got to go to the well.
And Yola.
Take a ride out in the country.
I can be Yola.
On sale now. Buy tickets at LiveNation.com or the FedEx Forum box office. Chris Stapleton's All-American Roadshow.
WynnBET is live in Tennessee and bringing you the action of real money sports betting right in the palm of your hand. Now you can get in on the action with all of your favorite teams across NBA, NFL, NHL, MLB, MLS, and more. Don't forget to take advantage of the generous promos, great odds, and unique parlays available in Tennessee on the WynnBET app. Head to the App Store to download the WynnBET app and sign up today. First-time bettors will receive a risk-free sports bet of up to $500. Terms and conditions apply for all promotion. Get the details at WynnBET.com. WynnBET.com. Must be 21 or older and present in Tennessee. Gambling problem? Call the Tennessee Red Line, 1-800-889-9789.
My name's Tony Tornado. I write and star in my own shows and movies. My crew knows that I dream of Hollywood. They also know that I love Mountain Dew. But there's so much more they don't know. Sometimes at night, I look up at the stars and think, I know why Mountain Dew is so crucial to my existence, but does anybody else? See, Dew's the green gold circulating through my veins. It makes Tony Tornado believe that he can do anything. So now you know my secret. But there's so much more you don't know.
Do the Dew.
Acadian Ambulance is proud to be an official partner of the Memphis Grizzlies and FedEx Forum, serving the greater Memphis area with exceptional emergency and non-emergency pre-hospital care. Acadian is looking for more Grizzlies fans to join our growing team of EMTs and paramedics, with opportunities in Memphis and other markets. Employee-owned, nationally recognized. Acadian Ambulance Service. Learn more at memphisemsjobs.com.
Have gold? Bring it to King. Grab everything you'll never wear again. King will buy all your gold jewelry or trade it for new jewelry and get 20% more. Have gemstones or diamonds you don't want to sell? Sentimental items passed down to you? King can use your gems or diamonds and create a new work of art designed with your own taste and style. Trade in your gold, let King design something that's all yours, or sell us your gold. There's no better time than now during gold buying and custom design days at King Furs and Fine Jewelry in Laurelwood, where custom design is our specialty.
It's just a few cocktails at happy hour.
There aren't any cops around.
After every game, we always have a few. It's no big deal.
It was just a few drinks. I'm good.
Hey, I can hold my liquor.
I drink and drive all the time.
If you put away some drinks, put away your keys. Fans don't let fans drive drunk. Brought to you by the Tennessee Highway Safety Office.
Live from FedEx Forum in the American Home Shield Studio, this is the Chris Vernon Show on GrindCityMedia.com, presented by WinBet. Now, here's your host, Chris Vernon.
GrindCityMedia.com. Chris Vernon Show. Welcome, 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 welcome. It is the Friday, June 4th, 2021 edition of the show. Today on the show, Kyle Anderson is going to check in. Taylor Jenkins is going to check in. It's media day. Everybody's leaving. Signing off. Let's do it. Turn it up. Hope everybody's having a good day. All right, we got a lot of stuff to get to. Everybody is saying their last words for the NBA season regarding the Memphis Grizzlies as they're having their exit interviews today, and then they will jump on their respective planes and head to a beach, I'm sure, for some rest and relaxation after what was a crazy second half of a season for sure. They went through post All-Star break not having 2 days off in a row for the until the end of the season, and then they played, you know, in the play-in, played two of those games, and then they played playoff games. And so I'm sure that a lot of them are very happy while disappointed that the season ends. Thrilled that they now, like, just don't have to do anything today except for a couple interviews, and then they can head off their merry ways. They deserve a vacation after the bubble and then what they had to do the second half of the season, playing every other day. Because while we experienced the wear and tear, we weren't running up and down a basketball court. Anyway, excited to talk to Kyle Anderson today, and we'll get Taylor Jenkins' thoughts on the show as well. My God, was it a unbelievable night last night for NBA basketball. Not necessarily the outcomes that I expected to stay up late to watch, and yet things have changed dramatically in just a year's time. Before I get to anything, I welcome John Roser to the show. John Roser, a.k.a. the Cologne Ranger, the Body Spray Band, the Senior Sack, a.k.a. John the Backbone, John the Backhead, a.k.a. the Grim Roser, John Hustle, Johnny Asparagus, Johnny Net Carb, a.k.a. John Prescott. What up?
Shout out, Roser High. Put up the tweet, Kimball. Put it up.
What?
Look at that. Right again. Go, Suns. Your false king failed you once again. Your false king failed you once again. False king. You all worship
one
a
quote
false
tweet.
King.
One quote tweet.
It was from me.
One
I quote tweeted it, yeah. And then that one got likes. Yeah, well, I don't know how many followers he has.
Well, I told you there's two in the Roserai.
There's way more than that. Oh, there's way more.
There's one more in the Roserai.
Way more than that.
Hey, you should have.
Talk Your about false not, king hey, laid hey, down look, look. Again.
You want to talk about not knowing how to crop a photo. Good grief, Roser. Leave out the part where it says one quote tweet.
Well, I quote tweeted it. I don't care about
one,
that. I don't care about that.
The one is the loneliest number.
It was a great tweet.
Who's the person?
Ryan,
that,
shout out to him.
Who's the person that cared about this? Oh, you!
For remember me. Well, it's 12:22 a.m. A lot of people were sleeping. Yeah. But the LeBron haters, no retweets. We are out in full force. The false king fails once again. Laid down for what? I don't know, like the 10th time in his career in the playoffs. Just completely lays down.
Hey, Devin Walker's here. He is the microphone mangler. He is Senor Quasadilla. He is Mr. Matthews, Navajo Joe. He is the reporter.
Rose is trying to be a cheap-ass Skip Bayless right now.
He is.
He's trying to be Skip Bayless.
That's what
right
he is.
Shout out to Skip Bayless. That's a hero of mine, man.
Drip Bayless, man.
Shout out to Skip Bayless. Shout out to Skip Bayless.
Bro, I'll tell you this.
A1 day one.
I'm going to tell you this. If you view it, like there's still a lot of people out there that – don't view it through the prism of entertainment, but rather view it through the prism of, you know, this is, you know. And that,
like
look,
Richard Deitch.
And certainly he really believes what he is saying. I actually think he really believes what he is saying. But when you just think of it as entertainment, him immediately tweeting after the game, he has always been overhyped and overrated. I was like, God, it's his 18th year. The guy's going to go down as the number one leading scorer in NBA history. He's won titles. It's so funny to me that he's like, he's always been overrated and overrated. Like, can you imagine? Like, it's him and that guy, right? He's made literally millions of dollars just being a hater, man.
Hey, also, just a real hater. Wait, Roser mentioned that tweet. He didn't even like the tweet, by the way. Just another note. You didn't even like the own tweet about your own hive.
So funny.
Yeah. I mean, Roser's hive is... I'm selective in my life.
It is really...
He said I'm selective in my life.
Very diminished. Go look at the last thing Roser liked.
It was something from earlier today, probably about the Roser hive, I think.
Find out, look, he's going to go through and try to delete right
now.
I'm not going to delete anything.
I'm not going to delete any of my stuff. I've liked more stuff in the last week than I have, like,
you just said you were judicious about it.
I usually am.
Now we're going to find out he's Johnny
Light.
Oh,
my God. Look, what? He's liking a bunch of tweets slandering LeBron.
Oh, yeah. Shout out to Katie Forbes. Shout out to Katie Forbes for this one. LeBron James leaving the bench early doesn't surprise me at all. LeBron is not a team player. He's good at pretending to be one when it personally benefits him. It's always been that way. He's not some phenomenal leader. He's just very good at basketball. Shout out to you, Katie Forbes. Shout out to you. Love that.
Liking LeBron slander.
If I could like that tweet a million times, I would.
What is the last non-LeBron related like that Roser has?
The last one I had.
From Michael Young. Always been appreciative of John Roser for the way he treated me when I was an intern at 730, but it's time I officially become a Roser Hive card-carrying member.
Oh, God.
Michael Young, Mr. Okay. That's that guy.
Look, I told you that everything has changed dramatically.
We also may have an update. It looks like Taylor Jenkins is going to join us in like 10 minutes.
What?
Yeah. It's an update I just got in my headphones.
Oh, really?
Yeah, Taylor Jenkins is going to join us in 10 minutes.
There you go.
Yeah.
All right. Look, the final eight in the bubble last year, this is the final eight teams. Toronto, they missed the playoffs.
Yeah.
Milwaukee, on to the second round. Miami, swept in the first round. Boston, lost in the first round. Denver, on to the second round. Clippers, they're down 3-2.
Yeah.
Houston, missed the playoffs. Lakers lost in the first round. If the Clippers lose to Dallas, there's going to be two teams.
Yep.
From the eight.
Yeah.
In the bubble. And one of those is massively depleted.
Yeah.
In Denver.
Yes.
Right? I mean, I saw that this was the saddest damn thing I ever seen in my life. I mean, okay, that's a little strong. It's sad. I saw a guy that writes for Blazers Edge. Now, you know that a guy that writes for Blazers Edge, he loves his Blazers.
Oh, yeah.
He loves his Blazers, right? That's why he does it. It's a passion project. And he wrote the following last night. This is sad. He said, well, I guess we have to come to terms, and I'm paraphrasing. I guess we have to come to terms with the fact that a 65% Nuggets team is still better than the Trailblazers. And I was like, oh, that's tough. That is tough. And it is also so. You know what I mean? Like Jokic, like if anybody was out there that was, you know, thinking, hey, this guy, is this guy really, should he be winning the MVP? It's Monty Morris. It's Austin Rivers. It's Jermichael Green. Michael Porter Jr., you know, had 26 and he had the 6 threes in the first quarter. But I mean, like, winning a playoff series with what he has left. Like, and to that point, listen to this, Roser. I went back. Once that series was set, you know, because now it's going to be Phoenix-Denver. I was like, I wonder what happened when they played. So I went back and looked, and they played three games, two of which Denver won, right? And one of them went to overtime, and the other one went to double overtime. And I was like, ooh, like maybe these teams. And then I pulled open the box score. There was one player, Jokic, in the starting lineup for the Nuggets in both those, the overtime and the double overtime game. One. In the lineup.
Wow.
That will be in the lineup, starting lineup when they play. So, I mean, obviously, it gives me no basis for what I think could happen. It's literally a different basketball team. It was Jokic, and then the other four, Jamal Murray, Gary Harris, Will Barton, Paul Millsap. And then you look at last night, and who's playing in that game? I mean, that's insane. That's January that they played those games. So in January, those teams played against each other, went to overtime and double overtime, and when I pulled up the box score, there were four guys that were playing for the Nuggets in the starting lineup with Jokic that none of them were in the starting lineup last night and won't be in the starting lineup when they start their series against the Suns. That's incredible, man. I mean, if you want to, there ain't no poking holes in that dude. There's one guy that still remains. How are they good? You know? Now, the truth is, they got a lot of good players. I always talk about not playing players that suck.
Mm-hmm.
And Portland was forced into doing that.
Yeah.
You know, especially throughout this series. Anytime Nurkic wasn't on the court, they got slaughtered. Bad. You know, they had to, you know,
Jefferson.
They're trying to play Hollis Jefferson. Yeah. They're trying to play these guys.
Mello, I mean, Nas,
kind of crazy.
Yeah,
kind of crazy, right? And you know, look, that's going to blow up Portland. That's 4 out of 5 years they've gotten bounced in the first round.
You see Dame's quote last night?
Yeah, I saw it. The Nipsey Hussle.
Yeah, and then,
how long do I stay dedicated or whatever?
Yeah, before.
I mean, I just think there's going to be major overhauls. What's going to happen? They will make sure that Dame stays there.
CJ's,
but I mean, if you're CJ McCollum, I'd go ahead and start packing my bags.
Nurk didn't sound too good either last night.
No, he didn't.
Yeah, like,
but
Alton dudes, like,
but again, they're gonna alter that greatly. I mean, and that is, it's the blessing and the curse, right, that comes along with making the Western Conference Finals. What I will say regarding the Grizzlies is it wasn't a bunch of first-round ousters as to why they, like, stuck around with it, right? They weren't getting bad. 4 out of 5 years, that team's gotten bounced in the first round, and one of them, they made that run to the Western Conference Finals. That's it, you know? But, I mean, you can't get bounced in the first round, 4 out of 5 years. Like, what are we doing here? You know?
Yeah.
I mean, at some point, it's like, what are we doing here?
Yeah. How long
one year we made our run, and then they, honestly, they got swept by Golden State when they did make that run, right? It's not unlike when the Grizzlies did make their run, they got swept by San Antonio, right? Yeah. You're not that close.
Just ran into a buzz saw.
But what it also was you're not that close. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
But you also were playing second round series most of those years, yeah. Right? The Grizzlies weren't routinely getting bounced in the first round. And so they stuck with it, but now you've got 4 out of 5 that these guys have gotten ousted. And so Jokic, you know, probably blew that thing up last night. So there's going to be a lot of alteration with that. And also, you know, at that night, you got the Suns moving on. And so now neither of the finals teams are going to be there. Lakers are gone. Heat are gone.
Yeah.
And then, as I told Rosa earlier, 6 of the 8. If the Clippers lose,
yeah,
6 of the final 8 teams from last year are not going to be in this thing.
Wow. And the first
8.
That's crazy.
It is pretty
wild. It's the first time in 10 years Steph or LeBron's not in either.
10 years?
First time in 10 years. Steph or LeBron won't be in the finals.
All right. Well, the Grizzlies just got done with their season. What a whirlwind it was. Not a lot of days off, and then went straight to the play-in, then went straight to the playoffs. And now exit interviews are today. And the head coach of the Grizzlies is joining us on the show. Ayo, how you doing, man?
I'm doing, Chris. It's been a minute since we've seen each other. How you been?
I know, and now I have to see you on Zoom, and nobody gets to see anybody anymore. Hopefully things will get a lot more back to normal. As you had a chance to, you know, obviously you're on that flight home yesterday and then last night. It's the first night that you don't have to prepare for something in a long, long time, and you're trying to, like, decompress from everything that takes place. What stuck with you? Like, what were you thinking about the most? Was it still the series that you just played? Did you start thinking about the season as a whole? Did you start thinking about the off season already? Like, what went through Taylor Jenkins' mind?
A lot. You know, there was definitely something to prepare for. Obviously, exit interviews today and, you know, a final talk with the team to kind of deliver my final messages. But a lot of reflection, you know, on an unbelievable season. So unique, presented a lot of different challenges, and our guys accomplished so much and never made excuses and have continued to fortify the foundation that we're building here in Memphis. And I'm just, you know, prideful, you know, flight home. Obviously, you don't want to lose. You know, our guys are so competitive. We wanted to advance. We wanted to move on. We wanted to have a game 6 here at home in front of our great fans. But, you know, when reality sets in, it allows you to go back and reflect and understand, wow, look at what we accomplished this year as a group. But then also, what do we have to do moving forward? Trying to collect my thoughts, and that's what we address with the team today is, you know, what do we have to do to get back to this point? There's more work to be done. You can't be satisfied. You know, the group has always been the most competitive team, but we understand it's not good enough. That was our takeaway from, you know, last season to this season. So a lot of those thoughts brewing up and, you know, trying to deliver a simple message to these guys about, you know, what we accomplished, the success that we had, why we had that success. It was because of the work and the togetherness and the unselfishness that we got out of everyone this year. But we need more of that moving forward. So that was kind of the flight. You know, I stayed up late last night, putting a lot of thoughts on paper, you know, so I can address each guy individually and help them understand, you know, takeaways from this year and what they got to work on and be motivated for next year as well.
Do you have any regrets about the season? Anything
None.
You wish you could have done differently?
I mean, there's always going to be things that I wish I could, you know, do better, differently in the moment. You know, I trust my preparation. I trust the team's preparation. That's our players and our staff to seize every opportunity that we got this year. You know, whether it was games, it was, you know, the unique schedule that we faced in the second half of the year. I give so much credit to so many people to allow us to be successful with all the challenges that we faced. But, you know, no regrets. I'm not a guy that lives with regrets. I'm a guy that's going to go back and reflect and watch a lot of film, talk to our players, talk to our staff, and say, what can I do better? What can I do better to put ourselves in a better position next year? So you always strive for perfection. You're never going to get perfection, you know, in this sport, in this line of work. So I'm motivated towards that. But I'm not going to be one that's going to regret a decision here and there. I'm just going to try to learn from, you know, my mistakes and understand, okay, the next time I face that, I'm going to be better prepared, because that's what allows us individually and as a team to go out there and be successful. We prepare, we work, and that's going to be our kind of MO for many years.
I remember there was a week this season where a guy came up to me, it was like a Thursday, and he was like, yeah, well, that was like the Pelicans game. And I said, what Pelicans game? And he's like, the Pelicans game on Monday. And I was like, wait, what? And I had like almost no recollection of the Pelicans game that Monday, because there have been like two or three games since that Pelicans game. I can only imagine what that was like with you. And so even yesterday when I was trying to put together like things that will stand out, things that I really will truly remember throughout the year, it was difficult because it was just so fast and there were so many of them. But for you, is there a few games that particularly stand out more than others for one reason or the other?
Yeah, I mean, I would you kind of put me on the spot there, but I would say it definitely all was kind of a whirlwind at times, especially that second half of the schedule. You know, I vividly remember probably stretches of games, that East Coast trip. I think we went Philly, Miami, Atlanta, New York. Could have gone 4-0 on that road trip, but going up against playoff teams.
Yep.
And we were still trying to pave our way in where we were, you know, standing wise. But going up against the Sixers, winning on their home floor, going down to Miami, beating them back to back in Atlanta, beating them. And some of those were convincing wins. That's a testament to our team and just embracing the challenges on the road. I think to the West Coast trip, that, you know, 13-day West Coast, 7-game trip, starting off in Chicago, then back-to-back against Milwaukee. You know, we have a heck of a game against Denver, come up short, lose guys at concussions, you know, guys in and out of the rotation, and we manage a 4-2 road trip against some of the best teams in the league, Eastern Conference and Western Conference. So, you know, I look more at stretches of the season. You know, one game doesn't define, you know, our success or, you know, our struggles during the year. It speaks more towards the resiliency and how our team, just especially with the games just one after the other, have a great ability to have quick closure, learn from that previous game, and seize the next opportunity, whether there was travel involved or not, no practice involved or not. You know, they're ready for the next opponent. And, you know, that's the thing that really jumps out to me, is just stretches of games. You know, and those are probably the two biggest ones that really stand out to me. And then obviously, you know, the 4-5 to finish the season, jumping right into having to play the Spurs, a really tough team, Golden State, who we just lost to, that stretch of the season right there, what we did, winning games that got us into great, you know, position in the play-in tournament, having to, you know, do or die game 7 mentality against San Antonio and Golden State, and then thrusting ourselves into the playoffs. That was a very special stretch of the season.
The playoffs are a different level of basketball, that's for sure. You get done with that series against Utah, and one of the things is we talk about playoff scars and learning lessons from it. From your mind's eye, what did that series tell you you guys have to improve at?
Well, I'd say the starting point is we can compete at that level. We can absolutely compete at that level. You know, we have to do more in a lot of different areas. We have to do more in understanding the importance of our habits, you know, the discipline that it takes one possession at a time. You know, I'm a broken record. Our players, you know, if they're watching this, they go, there he goes again. You know, the Utah Jazz were probably the one team in the NBA, and they've proven it, that they're going to make you pay when you make any mistake. But to give yourself the best chance against the best, you know, and everyone's playing their best basketball in the playoffs, you have to be at your best. And what has gotten you to that point is your habits. It's your discipline. It's your unselfishness. It's your ability to continue to get better from one game to the next. And we proved that all season long at a pretty high level. But at the playoff level, as you said, it's just heightened even more. It tests you even more. We got tested there, you know, at the end of the regular season, having to go through the play-in tournament, and our guys rose to the occasion. Played a lot of great basketball in a tough series against the Utah Jazz, but came up short for good reason. You know, our habits weren't there every possession for 48 minutes. Our discipline wasn't there for 48 minutes. You know, trying to play that perfect game as much as you try to stress in our offense, our ball movement, our unselfishness maybe wasn't there as much as possible. So our guys understood that. They saw it. We just couldn't execute it at that level compared to the Jazz were. So that's going to leave a taste in our mouth where, hey, we're that close toe-to-toe against the best team in the NBA. And we know what we can control moving forward, and let's let that motivate us in the summer and not wait till, you know, the end of season next year. Let's have that from day one in training camp.
Do you look like next year might be somewhat of a relief just because, like, you're kind of thrown into the fire as a rookie head coach, and then the season gets canceled and you got to finish it in the bubble. And then you come back the next year and you're playing a schedule where you're playing every other day for about 3 months. Like, just having some kind of normal season with a normal schedule next year may reap great benefits just for your own sanity.
Yeah, we've done good with the obstacles that have already been in front of us, so maybe we need more challenges. Who knows? But it'll be great. I think just big picture, you know, just for our communities, you know, getting back, you know, people healthy. Hopefully we can overcome this pandemic. Getting our fans back in the building, you know, that's one thing we sorely missed this year, you know, our great fans and that home court advantage. But, you know, I look forward to a true offseason, honestly, to be able to get hands on our guys, be able to come in here and work, see our group go out and compete in summer league, have an open gym where guys are coming back and voluntarily wanting to play 5-on-5 and get geared up for, you know, hopefully another successful season. So whatever comes our way, whatever challenges, we've been able to face them pretty head on. You know, if it's more in a normal kind of atmosphere, I think we'll be pretty good there too. So excited about what the future holds for us, especially this offseason, and ready to get back and compete very, very soon.
All right, last thing. I know that's all basketball stuff. What are you going to do? Are you going to go somewhere? You got a trip planned? How are you going to go decompress?
Well, the number one thing is obviously spending time with my family. Today's my my beautiful wife. It's her 40th birthday, so celebrating with her. In good fashion, you know, take some family trips here and there. My family loves going to the beach. We're gonna kick off, you know, at some point, you know, once summer league's done, going off to the beach and dive in, you know, with some trips here and there to get ready for this draft with Zach. You know, excited about that. And then anytime I can get into my backyard and watch my kids run around and have fun, that'll be fun. And then definitely mixing some date nights with my wife. So I take all the family stuff I can get during the summer, and then that allows me to go out there and get ready for a great season.
Awesome, man. Congrats on a great season.
Thank you,
I mean,
Chris.
It was such a whirlwind, but it exceeded everybody's expectations, certainly. Just getting playoff basketball again for the first time in so long. You miss it. You do. You miss it.
Yeah. Special season, and I said it, and I hope everyone heard it loud and clear. Playoff basketball in Memphis. That was such a cool phrase to say, and to experience that. And I know our guys are motivated. I'm even motivated more as well to get playoff basketball here in Memphis on a regular basis.
Thanks, man. Have a great offseason.
Same to you, Chris. All the best to you.
Thanks, Taylor. Taylor Jenkins, head coach of the Memphis Grizzlies. Certainly appreciate him popping on with us today. You know, it's odd to think back, but the truth is, right, you get a job for the first time last year, and then you get to March, and it's like, all right, your season stopped.
Yeah.
And you can't see your guys, and nobody can even be around each other. Like, it was interesting because, like, the things you take for granted, where he was like, I'm just excited to have a real offseason where guys can come to the gym and play. You know what I mean? Like, everybody, like, kind of went back home, and then you couldn't remember. It was like, they can come back, but they can just do individuals, and they can go work with a rebounder or whatever. It's like, and you heard, like, a lot of those guys. You heard Jaren and Ja and all them after the game, and they're like, yo, we're finding a gym, and we're going to be playing around and with each other throughout this summer, right? Like, that is an opportunity for us to really get even more, you know, court time together, practice time together, and more chemistry. And they are. I mean, a lot of them have bought homes here in Memphis, and so they're not going to be going their separate ways for the offseason. Especially, it's interesting that a lot of the young guys, a lot of young guys usually rent. Yeah. Our young guys bought houses, right? You know what I mean? So, I mean, they obviously, you know, are planning on being here, and this is where their homes are.
And they all live, like, kind of in the same, like, 10-minute radius of each other.
One, the two cornerstone players, their parents live here, too.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So it's not like you go back home to see mom and dad. They're right here.
Yeah.
They're down the street, right? And so I do think that could be a real benefit. But just for his point of view, I mean, man, you took that job, and then they cut off your season, and then the rest of it, you're living in a hotel, and you're playing bubble basketball. And then the next year, no fans. You know, you get halted for a week and a half, which then turns into we are going to play a game every other day for the next 2.5 months or whatever it was. you know, through the end of the season. And that's just not – it's not the mode of operation for a coach. Like, your preparation, your everything, right? Like, there's a lot of times during a regular season, you play on, like, a Monday night, you got a road trip starting on Thursday, right? And then you play a back-to-back, and you play, you know. But you go on a reasonable road trip. Like, the road trips were harder. The back-to-backs were extreme. And not having 2 days off between any games was crazy. Yeah. It was crazy.
Yeah.
Right? And the other thing is, you know, they had something going for 60 games. And then, you know, they had to try to implement Justice. They had to try to implement Jared. It's not easy. It was not that yeah. that was much more difficult than any of us expected. We expected it. You know, we live in the glass overfilled world where it's like, oh God, this team, and then you plug in Jaren. Holy crap! Look how much better you can be.
You live in 2K world.
But the truth is, bro, what you discount is you played 60 games another way.
Yeah,
you know, yeah. You played 60 games another way. And now you got to play it this way, all right, with this guy. And so it's unsurprising. Like, I saw our buddy Fast Break Breakfast put up, like, lineup stuff this morning, and it was, like, the lineups with Ja and Kyle and Dylan along with either Bain or Melton and then a center. Those were the best lineups throughout the year, and they were the best lineups in the Jazz series and whatever. Well, like, yeah. Because those are the guys that log the most minutes together. You know yeah. what I'm saying? Like, there's a chemistry that comes along with that. But what's the answer? I mean, when the answer is not playing Jaren Jackson Jr., that's not going to be so. You know what I'm saying? Because they want him to get those playoff reps and those playoff scars and be in that position also, right? That is one of those eye to the future decisions. Yes. Could you have been better playing some different lineups that included the guys that really played the 60 games together? Of course you could. You would not have won. I'm sorry.
Yeah.
You wouldn't have won. And then you would have gotten, right, a guy that's about to be up for an extension and a guy that is 21 years old. You wouldn't have gotten him in that situation. Because, look, going forward, he's going to be a big minute, high volume player. Like, that's what he's going to be going forward. And so that is one of those where, yes, it makes you worse in the interim. You have a better option right now, but the truth is you weren't going to win anyway. I'm sorry. Like, you weren't going to beat the Jets. I don't care what lineup you put together. It doesn't matter. They didn't lose because of lineups. They lost because they're not as good as the Jazz.
Yeah.
That's why they lost. They lost because they're not as good. Could they have won another game? Of course. Maybe. They weren't knocking that team off. Like, once they got Mitchell back.
No. Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
No.
Like, they weren't going to beat that team. And nobody expected them to win that series. Nobody. And so I do think that was just difficult, right, to try to implement that at the end of the season. But I do think it's going to serve all of them very well that they were in that position. And they played in those games. And they played when the lights were brightest. And they played when they were on national TV. And they played when there were fans bearing down on you. And they played when another team starts busting your ass, you know?
Yeah.
And how do you respond, you know, to that? And all that stuff is going to be invaluable going forward. As you chronicled many times, they're the youngest team to be in the playoffs in 10 years. You know? That's the truth of the matter.
You surpassed expectations for 2 years in a row when people didn't expect you to be there.
Well, there's a lot of people that, look, I don't know if it's gamblers. I don't know if it's people that don't pay attention all that much. But the people that, you know, blast Taylor Jenkins to me, I honestly don't even respond.
It's like,
I've been around, dude, I'm telling you. You guys can, look, has he made mistakes? Yes, I ripped them to death for that whole Justice thing. There are mistakes. Now, again, they have, like, what's called organizational alignment. I understand what they're trying to do. There are things that I have taken issue with, lineup-wise, all that kind of stuff the same way, right? But taking a step back and what they've done, like, these last 2 years, like, I've watched, God, I don't know, what did I say, 7 or 8? Maybe it's more than that. Different coaches here. Taylor Jenkins has done a very good job. He has done a very good job. You know what I mean? And they have been highly competitive when these are years where the expectation is not. You create your own monster, right? Once you start winning, you create your own monster. I mean, I saw this happen with Norvell. Remember that? Norvell had that huge year, and then what did he go to, like 8-4, like the next year or something like that, right? Now, obviously, they went to the orange. Was it the Orange Bowl? What bowl was that? The one against Penn State.
Oh, the Cotton Bowl.
Yeah, Cotton Bowl. Yeah, they went to that one, yeah. Right? That year, his last year before he got the four. What was the year before that?
8-6.
Huh?
8-6.
8-6.
Yeah.
People were telling me Mike Norvell stinks. You're just stupid. I mean, really. What'd they go the next year? They lost one game?
12-1.
12-1. And they lost to Penn State in a BCS, a New Year's Day game, for God's sakes. Like, stop. Right? But when he went 8-6, that's the thing, right? Once you win or you do well, people get this odd feeling of what should be expected, how good you should be at a certain point. And the truth is that they have – just go look at Vegas. Go look at Vegas. Go look at what they expected.
Yeah.
The Grizzlies to win the last 2 years. It's not even close. They buried that number 2 years in a row.
Last year they did it at the All-Star break.
Yes. Right. Buried the number 2 years in a row. I mean, that's all you have to say. Like, how can you be poorly coached? You buried the number. You buried it. What are you trying to tell me? Like, if they would have had so, like, what do you think this team, whoever you think is amazing, just name it. Who do you think is amazing? That's the problem with today. Nobody thinks anybody's a good coach anymore.
Yeah.
It's the damnedest thing. No, truly. Right? You sit around and think, and you go, who do you think is a great coach?
Spoelstra.
Popovich.
Yeah, he's okay. He won one last playoff game.
I know.
Popovich.
Popovich wasn't there.
Hadn't Carlisle. Been there 2 years.
Carlisle, he's there.
Stevens at the crib.
I mean, yeah, they moved off him.
Nick Nurse, not there.
Budenholzer.
So, I mean, who you think's great? No, people think he stinks.
I know.
I think Budenholzer stinks.
Yes. Yeah.
Wait, really?
Yeah,
there are a lot more people that are out there talking about how he's not good than he is good. And the guy wins like 60 games.
Monty Williams is a good one.
Now he is.
Yeah.
People didn't think that.
Yeah.
I still don't think Monty Williams is that good. I think it's Chris Paul.
I think Mike Malone's good. I think Mike Malone's a good coach.
I think Mike Malone's a good coach.
Mike Malone was just up by 8 with a minute left to go and almost lost because he didn't foul Damian Lillard. It's like...
Yeah. I'll tell you one who I think is good, but I think people do not think. I think Dwayne Casey's a good coach.
Of course he is.
Yeah. Casey's a good coach. And he just because he couldn't win the big one with Toronto.
Nate McMillan got fired last year.
And Terry Stotts is a good coach. He's going to get fired too. I mean, yeah.
Second round of the playoffs.
He might go to the finals.
Yeah.
I mean, the East finals.
That's what I'm saying, yeah.
If they don't have Embiid, he's going to go to the East finals.
Yeah.
And Indiana just didn't want to. I
mean, Doc Rivers is a good coach. Gets killed because he's blown like 2-3-1 series leads or whatever, like or three of them.
That's the thing.
But Doc Rivers is a good coach.
That's the thing nowadays, and it happens in the NFL also.
Yeah,
happens in every sport. Happens with baseball managers all the time, right? Like, I mean, look, Cubs fans, they didn't want Joe Madden anymore. Joe Madden won with the damn Rays,
yeah,
and then he won their first World Series in 100 years.
Yep, even I know that.
You know what I mean?
Yeah,
they don't want him anymore.
Yeah,
and now Angels fans probably don't like him. I don't know. I mean, it's crazy. Like, who do you think? Like, no matter who you think is good, you see anybody running around town talking about how awesome Popovich is anymore?
No.
You know what I mean?
Talk about it. What do you say he looks like, Devin?
He said he looked like Saul.
Jigsaw.
Yeah.
Jigsaw coach of the Spurs, bro.
You're wrong yeah. for that. Anyways, last night, as I told you, you know, one of the big stories that comes out of this is like those guys are not those teams, both finals reps, and if the Clippers lose, 6 of the 8 that were there last year in the final 8 teams won't be there, which is just insane.
The youth movement, man.
To think about.
The youth movement's coming. Don, Book, Trey, 12. Who am I forgetting? They're coming. You could tell they're coming. Like they like Ja limited Steph. Luca's about to eliminate.
Well, then you have that. You have that.
Well, you better. They went out in 5 games, but Jason Tatum's on there.
But you also have that group that now is like mid 20s. Later 20s that are hitting their absolute primes that are led by Giannis and led by Jokic.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Right? Like it's there. They're in that range right now where they've got the years. Like there was a – I remember last year, I think it was, and this doesn't bode necessarily very well for Utah. And I think that's true of a lot of teams. And I don't know. Check on Giannis's age and check on Jokic's age. I'm going to say that they're
both. Giannis is like 26.
Giannis 26.
Okay, I think it was last year and
Jokic
there was
Jokic is 26 also. Jokic turned 26 back in February.
Okay. I think it was that like if you went back and looked, I think there was like a Bird year and I think maybe I know Magic had that huge game at in the finals, you know, his rookie year, but Kareem was out for that game, but Kareem was still, you know, Kareem Abdul-Jabbar, a dominant force in the NBA. But I think if you go back and look, and I'm talking about even the guys that you think are like whoever was the best guy on a team, whoever. Name the guy. Like you say, this is the title team. Here is the best player on that team. What you will find is that if you go back for the 20, 30, 40 years, whatever you want, that player was 27 or older. That's what you're going to find.
Yeah.
That player is 27 or older.
Mm-hmm.
Almost across the board. There's like one or two. I'm serious. Like, ever, that are not of that. You think about that, right? Now, that's a long time to think about Ja Morant being 27 years old. Yeah. But I'm telling you, that is the truth. Guys that are, you know, those younger guys that are in the first 7-8 years of their career, what year did LeBron win? His first one. I mean, it would have been Miami. I bet he's
12.
Huh?
2012.
Bronze
and he came in the league in
03-04.
So yeah. He was over 27 even.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think he's right at there, 27-28.
So 27 would have been LeBron's year that he won it. Yeah, cuz I remember reading about this.
The first time as a 22-year-old.
Yeah. No, I'm saying win it.
Yeah.
I'm saying the year that you won the title. How old are, let's see, that second year in Miami, he was 27. He lost the first year at 26. And nobody's going to argue that Wade was the better player. I mean, Shaq was the better player on that Miami team that won it in whatever it was, 03 or whatever year that was. 06? Yeah, 06. But, yeah, I mean.
Well, Wade won finals MVP.
It's crazy to think about, though, isn't it? That's crazy to think about. The best player on the team is 27 or older. Nobody takes that into consideration. It doesn't happen until later.
Yeah.
Even for LeBron.
Yeah. You have to. There is.
You're not winning it. Nobody wins when their best player is 25. It's crazy, but it's true.
You have to grow up, man. There's a growing up to it. Like, you know, there's a maturation.
They're trying to break that. This next generation is trying to push that a little bit.
I know, right? Because you sit there and you go, well, geez, man. Can you imagine how bad they're going to be on Luka's ass if he hasn't won by 27?
Yeah, I know.
They were with Dirk, who was older, right? Like, Dirk was significantly older by the time he ended up winning it. And let me see on Jordan when his first one would have been. His first one was...
Jordan was 20... What,
was it 92?
No, 90, 91.
90, 91. He was 27.
Yeah, 27 years old.
So I remember reading that and going through and like reading this article, and it like listed all... I can't remember where it was, but they listed all... Whoever you would say, if you... Everybody would agree. The best player on that team, right? And they went through it one by one, every NBA champion, and then put their age. And I mean, and it was 27 or older, all of them. And I'm like, I mean, at some point, like, you got to, like, this ain't some kind of weird coincidence. Why does nobody win? Because I remember thinking about that when people were drilling Giannis last year. And I'm thinking, like, dude, if he did win it, if he did. Now, maybe you could argue, you know, he shouldn't have gotten ousted by the Miami Heat. He sure as hell didn't this year. But let's see. What you said he's 26?
Yeah, I'm trying to find Steph's first age.
Oh, Steph was way older because he played the 3 years at Davidson.
So he was 2015 was his first championship. He's 33 now. Subtract 7 years.
He was like 26, 27, 28.
26, 27. In the same range.
I mean, it's when it happens, right?
Yep.
Yeah. And we got to find when Giannis and Jokic, are either of them going to be 27 by the time?
Giannis turns 27 in December.
Yeah.
So he won't. He'll be 26.
Jokic just turned 26 like in March or February.
So maybe they'll just reduce it by a year.
Yeah.
If either of them, I mean, Jokic ain't winning a title with this team. Come on.
No.
He's done great. He's done great to get where he is.
Or Durant 32, Harden 31, Kyrie 29. Right.
Well, it also does not bode well for Philly. What really doesn't bode well is the
Joel Embiid's always hurt.
But how old is Embiid? He might be.
He's 27.
Damn!
It was his time.
I mean, he had that other... Like, if he didn't have the injury in the middle of the season, he was going to win MVP.
Hey, what's super crazy about it, and this is what I remember, what's super crazy is if you go back, how many are exactly 27?
Or
thereabouts. It's freaky. It's freaky how many are that age.
Yeah.
Or right at, 27, 28. So right. I suppose they could reduce it by a year.
The freakiest thing to me that I heard, because I was listening.
Well, here, go finish.
The freakiest thing that I heard, talking about the age, was I was listening to that Jackie McMullen, Simmons, Russillo, Celtics thing. Bro, and. Because we have watched him play. We have watched him play in conference finals already, like multiple times. But the fact that they just said Jason Tatum just turned 23, I'm like, dude, I feel like I have been watching that guy for 7 years now in Boston.
Katie was first at 28.
Just start reading him back.
Okay.
And we'll see how far you can go back. I think it's Bird. I'm not kidding.
Bird won his first at 24.
Okay.
D-Wade at 24.
Yeah, but D-Wade wasn't the best player on that team.
Okay. Kawhi.
Shaq was.
Kawhi at 23.
He wasn't. Okay. Did he win finals MVP at 23? Was that the year he won finals MVP or was that later?
No, he won it when he guarded LeBron.
So that was later.
Yeah, so they won in 5 games. Yeah. So he wasn't. This wasn't the
2003, he wasn't even a.
He averaged 18 a game in that season.
But he was not their best player.
Yeah, he won their best player. So let's see. We go best player.
Toronto's best player.
Tim Duncan at the age of 23. Duncan won his at the age of 23.
He was with Robinson.
Yeah. Bill Russell. Right?
And you know who was big in, what was it, game 6 or game 7?
Oh, Jaren Jackson Senior?
Yeah.
Bill Russell.
That was a veteran-laden team.
Yeah. Kobe at the age of 21.
Shaq was the guy.
Magic Johnson at the age of 20.
Okay.
John Havlicek at the age of 23. Bill Russell at the age of 23. Duncan, 23. Kyrie, 20.
Yeah, I'm not talking about what happened in 1950. Stop.
There were like 16 in the league.
You don't want George Mike in it?
No, George Mike.
Or Bob Pettit. All right, no. Scottie Pippen was with Jordan. He was 25. Steph, 24. LeBron, 27.
Wait, Steph, 24?
Oh, 27, my bad. 27. It was 27 years, 94 days, my bad. Isaiah Thomas, 28. Moses Malone, 28. Shaq, 28. Jordan, 28. KD 28.
This is crazy. KD.
Yeah.
KD.
Paul Pierce was 30. Wilt was 30. Hakeem 31. Dirk 31. KG 32. Oscar 32. Julius Irvin 33. Jerry West 33. Jason Kidd 38. And then it goes on.
Well, they it's always crazy, say, they though. Always like, say your big prime is like, what, like 27 to 33?
Yeah.
It's like right in there, 27 to 32.
That's crazy.
It's like that's the area.
Isn't it crazy? And maybe it's just the combination of, like, the talent is obviously there. Because you could argue, some of those, like, earlier seasons of all of those guys are much greater, right? Like, I'm talking about Jordan. I'm talking about Wilt. I'm talking about – there's a lot of those guys, obviously, with somebody like Kidd. But, like, there are statistical years. Even KG, there's statistical years that are better years.
Yeah.
So if you want to do the prime in stats, but what may happen is as you become around that age, you know, that 26 to 31, A, you're becoming more of an adult – for certain, but it's also like the reps and the knowledge, you know, of the game. And like, it's like almost like your brain catches up with your talent in terms of thinking about basketball situations, playing within a team context, all that stuff. Like, so you might have had, like, there may come a time where Luka is winning it, but he ain't averaging 50 and 10 and 10, right? You know what I'm saying? Same way as Jordan. He wasn't winning it when he was averaging 35 points a game or whatever the hell. Like some of those statistical seasons of any of those guys are just freaky, right? I mean, even the Jerry West stuff, you can go look at some of those. And it's just every year, this guy is one of the best. But it's like and look, guess who else has had bigger statistical years? Devin Booker.
But this is the year where he's finally –
how old?
Put it together. Let's see. Devin Booker's 24, I think.
Huh?
He is 24, yeah. His birthday's in October. He'll turn 25 in October.
I mean, there are those that would argue Chris Paul's the best player
on
that team, and that would be the guy, right?
He was in kill mode last night, man.
Who, Booker?
Oh, my God. That first quarter.
That was freaky. That was freaky.
That first quarter.
He was in kill mode, man.
Good Lord, man. I mean, he just could not miss.
He's an ish-talker, too, bro.
Oh, yeah, he is.
What was insane was Porter had 6 threes in the first quarter in the Nuggets game.
Yeah.
He didn't score again.
Nope. Yes, he did.
In the second half, he didn't score that much.
Who, Porter?
Yeah.
No, but he had 26 for the game.
Yeah.
But the next game, Booker had 6 in the first quarter.
Yeah.
Like, Porter Jr., I joked with Kevin last night. I'm like, don't you think he calls him? I'm like, bro, can I have one NBA record? Like, seriously? Like that, I got to have that record for 30 minutes. It was the most threes hit by a guy in the first quarter.
Wow.
Right? Which isn't that relevant, except for the fact that when Steph Curry inevitably does it, it's going to pop up on the screen. The last guy to do this was Michael Porter Jr. But instead, now it's got to pop up. The last guy to do this was Michael Porter Jr. and Austin. Or not Austin
Devin
Rivers.
Booker.
Might as well be Austin Rivers. That guy hits everything he takes now, too.
No, it's what's the funny thing is going to be is what Dame had, what, 12 threes in a game in the playoffs a couple games ago, which was, what, the record or whatever?
Yeah.
No, what's going to be funny is next year, like, Curry's just going to hit 12 in a quarter.
No.
He's just going to say, see what 12. You guys did last
year. If you do that in a quarter, bro, I'm going to take my shirt off, bro. 12 threes in a quarter?
Dude, Klay Thompson scored like 40 points in a quarter. Like,
30, no, it was 37.
37, yeah.
I mean, three dribbles?
There is once a year where I've typed that in on YouTube and watch it.
The Klay game?
Dude, it's the most insane thing you've ever
seen. It's against Sacramento, right?
It is outrageous. Outrageous.
I mean, it's wild.
He took 4 dribbles.
Yes.
4.
No, it's outrageous. And some of those that he hits are just like, you're like, dude, how?
Yeah.
It is a level of unconsciousness that is just impossible to fathom. Bro, you only play 12 minutes. You got to score 3 points a minute and then find another bucket. There should not be time to do that.
No.
There's just no way there's time to do that. How do you score 3 points a minute? Alone! That's nobody else scoring.
Hey, take a wild guess who was chasing morale.
Ben McLemore?
Ben McLemore. Ben Ben was getting drilled, bro. The thing is, he took the three dribbles on the first one. He used all the dribbles on the first one.
Just the first one.
And he just caught.
And then the rest of them were all catch and shoot the rest of the way.
Clay is in fuego, man. I can't wait to see him back next year.
Huh?
I can't wait to see him back playing next year.
Yep.
Because Clay is
Oh, yeah. No. He's fun to watch. Missed having him around. That's for sure.
Top five light-skinned players in the league.
Yep. It's odd to see all that number. So, I mean, I guess we could say who is left of the 27s?
Let's see.
You said Embiid.
Okay, let's see.
So he applies. Giannis is 26, so that would be a year younger than what we've talked about.
Let's see. Bradley Beal is 27.
No, he's done.
He's done.
Who's left?
Oh, they're left. Okay, give me a C.
Trey's not.
Trey's not.
And then who's the other team they're playing?
They're playing
Philly.
Philly.
And then you've got, and then all the Brooklyn guys.
We got a 27-year-old coming up on the show in a little bit.
So that's all the Brooklyn guys. And then on the other, on the West, Kawhi.
Kawhi's 30.
No, I'm saying, but he's up against it right now. I mean, he's got to come back and win. So he's the best player on one of the teams.
Yeah. Kawhi's 29. Yeah, Kawhi.
Jokic is two. He's not 27.
He's not 27.
And then.
Luke is not. Paul's older. Paul's older.
So Chris Paul.
Yeah.
And there's nobody on. And then Donovan's not.
Donovan's not.
Was he 25?
He's young. Don's like.
Well, he played a couple years at Louisville.
Don's 24. 24? He'll be 25 in September.
Okay.
So, yeah. He's getting. Dang, he's getting.
So, if history held, Chris Paul, Roser's Nets, or Embiid. Right?
Yeah. Or Giannis, because Giannis would be 20. Giannis. Is that 26, 27 range?
Well, 26 is. Younger than.
Yeah.
Because he would theoretically win it when he's 26.
Yeah.
So it'd be Embiid, Paul, Kawhi. Was there one other? Or is that it?
I think that as far as.
And the Brooklyn. Roser's Nets.
Roser's Nets. Yeah.
All right. Let's take a quick break. I think Kyle Anderson's going to join us on the other side. Chris Vernon, show.
WynnBET is live in Tennessee and bringing you the action of real money sports betting right in the palm of your hand. Now you can get in on the action with all of your favorite teams across NBA, NFL, NHL, MLB, MLS, and more. Don't forget to take advantage of the generous promos, great odds, and unique parlays available in Tennessee on the WynnBET app. Head to the App Store to download the WynnBET app and sign up today. First-time bettors will receive a risk-free sports bet of up to $500. Terms and conditions apply for all promotions. Get the details at WynnBET.com. WYNNBET.com. Must be 21 or older and present in Tennessee. Gambling problem? Call the Tennessee Red Line, 1-800-889-9789.
I'm Corey B. Trotz with the law firm of Nahan Saharovich & Trotz. We fight big insurance companies every day to help our injured clients get paid.
It's time for NST to lower the boom on.
Call 683-7000 because our team of lawyers knows the law to help convince the insurance companies on why our clients deserve more money.
That's NST strong.
I'm Corey B. Trotz, and we'll work to get you lots.
NST is the way to go. Call 683-7000.
Horseshoe Tunica is your place to watch all the Memphis Grizzlies games. You'll catch every dribble, every pass, and every swoop. Whether you're looking to grab some food or meet up with friends, Horseshoe is the place to be. Come in today and see why Horseshoe is your favorite place to watch all the action. Horseshoe Tunica, official partner of the Memphis Grizzlies. Must be 21 or older to gamble or attend events. Know when to stop before you start. Gambling problem? Call 1-800-522-4700.
Have gold? Bring it to King. Grab everything you'll never wear again. King will buy all your gold jewelry or trade it for new jewelry and get 20% more. Have gemstones or diamonds you don't want to sell? Sentimental items passed down to you? King can use your gems or diamonds and create a new work of art designed with your own taste and style. Trade in your gold, let King design something that's all yours, or sell us your gold. There's no better time than now. During gold buying and custom design days at King Furs and Fine Jewelry in Laurelwood, where custom design is our specialty.
So you know how part of the reason they did the possession era is because referees can't throw a ball 6 feet in the air straight up. Now we have drone technology. So we put the ball on a drone.
On a drone.
Fly it over the thing. Have the drone sponsored. have it spot. You sponsor? Put a camera up there, put a sponsor on it. Hey guys, it's time for the Mountain Dew drone jump ball. Thing flies out there, perfect every time.
Get your sports betting picks and trends with Lang Whitaker and Rob Fisher, the Odds Couple.
Welcome to the Spicy Drive-In. May I take your order?
Can I get the spicy chicken sandwich, please?
May I make a beverage pairing recommendation this evening?
Sure.
I would recommend the Mountain Dew with that. It's bravely unrestrained with a very alive aroma that pairs wonderfully with your spicy chicken.
Yeah, that sounds amazing.
The muscular flavor charge characteristics of Mountain Dew make for an absolutely epic mouthfeel when paired with spicy cuisine. It is quite on point, sir.
Like they were made for each other.
When you want to make good food bolder and bold food better... Do the do.
It's just a few cocktails at happy hour.
There aren't any cops around.
After every game, we always have a few. It's no big deal.
It was just a few drinks. I'm good.
Hey, I can hold my liquor.
I drink and drive all the time.
If you put away some drinks, put away your keys. Fans don't let fans drive drunk. Brought to you by the Tennessee Highway Safety Office.
Welcome back to the Chris Vernon Show on GrindCityMedia.com. Presented by WinBet. Live from the American Home Shield Studio inside FedEx Forum. Be sure with the shield and go to AHS.com today for your free no-obligation home warranty quote. Now, back to your host, Chris Vernon.
We don't have to worry about no money. All right, we're back. Chris Vernon Show. It's super excited to be joined by Kyle Anderson, coming off a career year for the Grizzlies this year. What's up, man?
Yo, what's going on?
Oh, you always have good t-shirts. Always. All right, you know, Roser, my producer, he's got his most viral tweet because of your t-shirt, the Tony Soprano t-shirt.
And
so now we need to know, where did you acquire the Tony Soprano t-shirt?
That seems like the million-dollar question everybody's asking me. I got it. One of these, I seen it on Instagram. This little store, Grace Co., something like that. And my sister looked into it, was able to order it for me. But yeah, I seen it once, and I knew I had to have it.
Wait. So was it an Instagram ad? How many things would you say you've bought off Instagram ads?
They said many shirts?
Yeah, no, just anything. They slaughter me, Kyle. They know exactly what I like. I can't stop.
You got to see if it's real or fake. If it's real, then I've gotten quite a few things off Instagram ads, but you can't get bamboozled by the fake ones.
You cannot. All right, Grace Co. That's what. All right,
something like that.
You're probably gonna sell them a million T-shirts now.
I hope so. Everybody, I hope they send me some more.
Everybody wanted to know.
Oh man, they have an amazing Deion Sanders shirt. An amazing Deion Sanders.
Are you looking
Sanders
at it right now?
He's looking at it.
Yeah. And a Nia Long shirt. Oh man,
they got some good.
They don't have the Tony Soprano one on here though.
Kyle got the only one.
Yeah,
it's probably one. Probably limited edition, right?
Yes, sir.
All right. Why did Kyle Anderson have a career year?
I think just being healthy in the offseason, getting able to really put the work in like I've had since I was 11, 12 years old. I think just getting back to those habits of, you know, being in the gym, twice, three times a day, that really helped me out. So, I just want to get back to that this summer. I miss those days, and I'm excited for it, really.
I felt like, and you're the perfect person to ask about this, I felt like I kept on relating to people that Utah thing felt so much like the old Spurs series we used to have, where they remind me so much of teams even that you were on, which were two things. A, sharing the ball unbelievably, and B, like just the seemingly inability to be able to get on a run against them, right? And so that's why I say you're the perfect person to ask. You were part of those Spurs teams. Did you see similarities when you're playing against them?
Yeah, definitely. That's funny. That's I spoke about that with my friends that, like, you know, they kind of remind me of our Spurs teams that we had. You know, just their their willingness to take and make threes. They're a very unselfish team, and then they got guys who can, you know, break you down and score individually. And then the way they play together so well is pretty impressive. So that's a good comparison. I kind of thought the same thing.
When you think back about this season, and you haven't had a ton of time to decompress, but like, what particularly stands out to you?
To me, about this season, I was happy with being available for how many games did I play? I forget. I looked at it the other day.
You played a lot, man.
Or whatever. Just the minutes I was able to log. I really wanted to challenge. I never used to do well on back-to-backs in my career. So, we had a lot of them this year. I really wanted to challenge myself on the second game of back-to-backs, just to be ready. And I don't know. It was just a good season. I had a lot of fun playing the game, really.
What'd you do differently for the back-to-back thing?
Just working out a little bit harder. Paying a little bit more attention to my diet, the things I eat, so I'm not tired or run down when that second game with a back-to-back comes up. Just a few changes, and it actually paid off. I felt really good all season.
You know what's crazy, Kyle? We were just talking about how you are. You're 27 years old, and we went back through, like, all of the title teams, and almost across the board, even for, like, the last several decades, the best player on the team is 27 or older. Like, and that includes LeBron, that includes Jordan, like, whatever. And so there's something about, like, that age and then older. Do you, right, when you hear that, and then you just had a career year at 27, do you think it is coincidence? Do you think it is a matter of maybe, like, you know, the talent catch, you know, the brain catching up with the talent basketball-wise and things start to come easier, or attention to detail, like you were talking about making an adjustment to back-to-backs? Like, why do you think that is?
I'm not sure, really. I don't know what it is. I think with my situation, I think it was my son made it really simple. Like, it just kind of lit a fire in my ass. Like, you know, just, I don't know, it's just having someone there watching you every day. If I want him to be a good, successful basketball player, then I got to kind of do the things that I want him to do, and the right habits, and not just lead by, you know, by telling him, but leading by example. So I give a lot of credit to my son being born. He just kind of really pushed me to go harder, really, and he doesn't even know it.
I had a theory that you guys were better on the road than at home because so many of you have very young children. I went through it twice, so I know what this is like. But I'm like, right, no wonder they play good on the road. Like, they get some sleep when they're there. If you're at home with a toddler or an infant, it's impossible.
Yo, I be laid out in those Four Seasons beds, like, sleep until 10 a.m. is beautiful. Like, I get all the sleep I could. My poor fiance, she has to stay home and have rough nights with Cameron. But no, and I kind of see a little truth in that theory. It's tough sleeping with a baby that's 15 months old. You know, yep, they have trouble sleeping through the night sometimes. So there could be a little truth behind that.
You already started talking about his basketball career. Is he baby tall?
He's huge, man. Like, I don't know the size of, like, normal 16
kids,
month old babies, but I he's has to be, like, you know, he's huge. It's crazy.
does he already sit in front of the TV? Will he watch stuff or no?
Yeah. He loves watching basketball. He loves watching the Mets with me. He likes football too. I just moved his shooting basket up a level higher, and he's making baskets already. He kind of figures it out. So it's pretty awesome.
Wow. He's already got a guy that you've already got a little hooper in the house.
Definitely.
This year, in terms of the challenges of it, especially that playing a game every other day or whatever it was, how do you think why was the team able to make through it without, like, ever, like, having some kind of, like, super long losing streak, or that the schedule catching up to you in a way that could have put you guys outside of even playing in a play-in?
Well, we got a really deep team. Like, it's like unfortunate some of our guys got to be out of the rotation at the end of the year. But it's like those guys would start, be cornerstones somewhere else. We just got a really deep team. We trust each other. If a guy does go down, or maybe two people go down, we trust in the next man up. And we got a lot of depth, man. That's really all you got to say about that. We can go 11, 12, 13 deep sometimes.
I thought it was interesting. I saw quotes, I guess, from your media session earlier. I guess people asked you about, you're wanting to be here as this goes through, right? And because, look, you're old, you're a veteran on the team. You joked at the beginning of the season, right, that you're the old head or whatever, even at 27. Right. But, I saw your quotes, like, that you want to be a part of this, that you want, like, this isn't now you are of the age where, hey, I want to go try to win now, right? I want to go try to win while I'm 27 and maybe go to a more veteran team that's going to be competing for championships. Like, you think that it can happen here and that it's not necessarily as far off from competing at the highest level as people might think from the outside?
No, I don't think so. I think what we got going on right here is definitely the best situation for me. I don't think everybody else believed that maybe coming into the season. So that was kind of like my whole motivation in the all season is just to like show that I can belong, that I do belong, and then that I can help this team when I am my normal self. So, no, I definitely want to be here, man. It's, there's no secret with that. I believe we can win games and get to the playoffs next year just like we did this year and advance and go from there for sure.
All right, give us one to look up for the highlight. We love the slow-mo Euro. It happens throughout the year. Is there a Kyle Anderson favorite from this year? One that stands out more than others?
My Euro?
Yes.
I would say it wasn't really like a Euro, but I would – okay, two, I'd say the Minnesota one. I had early on the year. I think it was on D-Low maybe. The Euro and scored it. I think that was pretty nice. They played in the intro video. And then the other one was the Timberwolves at home too over McLaughlin, the point guard from USC. And then I laid it with the left like that. That was probably those are probably my favorite two right there.
We're gonna pull the clips for certain.
also, Kyle, keep trying to bring back raising the roof.
Oh,
when you threw the lob off the backboard to Ja, I was like, Kyle is trying to bring back raising the roof.
To raise the roof.
Nah, my teammates were like, why'd you raise the roof? You guys never like they've never seen He Got Game. He got a game where in the park they throw it off he catches the dunk off the backboard and he goes, I got hops. So that's what I was really doing right there. That's from He Got Game. I got hops. So nobody really got that. But
we're pulling the clip.
I'll keep bringing it back.
We're gonna find the He Got Hops clip, that's for sure. And I'm glad you clarified that because it's really stuck with you these last couple of months. People are like, Kyle Anderson was raising the roof. Which everybody thought it was funny, but now that we know there's maybe a different story to it, it's even funnier.
Right, exactly.
And so, the fact that nobody on your team except for you has seen He Got Game.
Exactly.
It's not like it's Gone with the Wind or something, you know? You figure they'd watch their basketball movies.
We got a young team, man, young team. They're not familiar with Superbad. It's crazy.
Wait, what?
Are you serious?
Not Superbad.
Oh, my God. That's unbelievable.
The Hangover, Superbad.
Yep.
Dang.
All right. last thing. Where are you going to go? Where's decompress time? It's hard to find a fun place to go with a 15-month-old, but you still going to try to go to the beach or something?
Yeah, you can catch me at the Jersey Shore all summer. I'll be down there soaking up some sun on the beach, just hanging out.
Oh, you and Snooki.
Yeah. Yep.
Ronnie, and you get all – the situation, I'm sure they're probably filming down there. You can go say hey to all of them. Kyle, you're the best. Thank you, buddy. Hey, congrats on an awesome season.
Thank you. Thank you, guys. Appreciate you guys for having me. I'll see you next season.
All right, brother. Kyle Anderson.
Dude, he's the best.
He
man.
Is. He's the best.
Kyle's awesome.
We love Kyle Anderson. We are Kyle Anderson fans. I love the explanation on the raise the roof.
Yeah. And the fact that nobody's ever seen He Got Game.
I've seen He Got Game. And I'm like, but it's been a long time since He Got Game.
That's a pretty good.
We got to find the clip.
Oh, we'll find it.
So that we can sync it up. I got hops. I got hops.
Yeah, we'll find it.
Especially with the, you know, because if we can, there's a goal for today, Devin. See if we can mash up Kyle doing it in the game.
Yeah.
The lob off and the backboard of John.
Right.
Yeah. Whoa, wait. You want the hold on, wait.
I want him doing it while he's talking about it.
Yes.
And then the clip from He Got Game. Inevitably, the clip will be on there somewhere.
Yeah.
We can find it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? I got hops. I had no idea.
Yeah, that's we all thought he was raising the roof. That's I mean, we've seen He Got Game. We've all seen it. It's been a long time since I've seen He Got Game. That movie is long. It's a Spike Lee joint. It's, of course, it's long.
So long.
Spike Lee movies are long.
It's fun. I really can't remember the last time.
No, I can't
it's
either.
It's been a long – I need to watch that again.
It has. It's been a long time. It was really on Netflix for a while. Time.
I took it off.
It's a great movie.
I haven't watched – I mean, there's a ton of those.
I mean, those
Jordans.
It's been
so long.
The Jordans that are in there, what are those? The 13s, I think, that are in there?
No idea.
The ones that Denzel puts on?
They're called the He Got Games.
Yeah, they're called the He Got Games. Like, those things are freaking expensive ones. Like, you try to buy them on the secondary market, and man, they're expensive.
Oh, is that right?
Yeah.
Well, yeah. You know, look, hopefully next year everything is all back to normal. By the way, can I just say this regarding the normal thing? And this has nothing to do with anything that we've talked about today. Have y'all gone to places where the sign says, you know, we appreciate, you know, if you would wear a mask if you are not vaccinated or whatever? A lot of places have
now,
right?
Young Avenue's like that.
Huh?
Young Avenue Deli is like that.
Yeah, but basically there's a sign on the door because I always check to see, like, hey, do I need to wear a mask in here?
Yeah.
And it'll say, if you're not vaccinated, please wear a mask, whatever. And I'm just going to verbalize this because I don't know what's so. I've gone to like three or four places like that and been the only person that is like not wearing a mask. And then I sit there and I wonder, are people just wearing masks because they want to wear masks and because it's like, or like, are these people not vaccinated, and so that's why they're wearing their masks? Like, I'm telling you, it's been three or four places.
Yeah.
I'm like, why do people not want to not wear masks? It's got to be one or the other, right? Like, you either are choosing to wear it still, or maybe it's like a peer pressure. I don't know. But bro, if you tell me I don't have to wear one, I'm not wearing one.
No, I'm not.
I'm telling you, I've been in like three or four places, and my wife went to... Where was it? Whole Foods, two nights ago. Big sign. You know, unvaccinated people, please wear a mask or whatever. She said she was the only person in the entire store. She didn't, like, bring her mask.
Yeah.
Because she was, you know, she's vaccinated.
Yeah. No,
and so she walked around. And she's like, are all those people unvaccinated? Or are people just still wearing masks?
I always keep mine in my car, and I will wear it as I'm going in someplace. And when if I see other people inside not wearing one, I just take
mine. Oh, so it's a peer pressure.
It's a peer pressure. Well, if it makes you feel better, nobody at Young Avenue last night was wearing one.
I know. I'm not saying. No, it doesn't make me feel better. I'm just saying.
Mine's more like
it makes
gas
me
stations.
Feel weird when I walk in. Yeah. Like, well, are people doing this on?
Well, some so certain gas stations I've gone to, they still require you to wear one. Fine, put it on, wear it. But like other ones I've gone to, like I know some exes, they don't care.
I'm only talking about the places that say you don't have
by choice. Yeah.
If you tell me I don't have to, I ain't wearing it. I don't. My
either.
Gym doesn't require it. I don't wear it.
When I walk,
if you're vaccinated, you don't. Have to
I'm
wear
saying
it.
I've been in three or four places where it's like it says if you're vaccinated, you don't have to wear one, and so I don't. And then I walk in and I'll be like, why am I the only person without a mask?
Yeah.
Oh, we missed the opportunity. We forgot to ask Kyle about his sore thumb.
His what?
His sore thumb. Remember his sore thumb he had?
No, oh, man.
Damn it.
But yeah, keep going.
Him overcoming that.
Oh, yeah.
That was huge.
It's huge, man.
For him to overcome the sore thumb, and be able to play in the San Antonio game was massive. And it's one of those, you know, we'll go down in history. Dang it, I did forget about that.
Dang it.
Well, that was, again, it was so damn long ago.
Yeah,
it all runs. It all runs together. How good is that website, Roser?
There's only a couple shirts on there. There are only three shirts on there.
Hmm.
There was I sent you the Deion Sanders. I texted you the Deion Sanders one.
Okay, I'll look. At it.
Deion Sanders, Nia Long, and Tupac.
There's a lot of websites like that now where like they sell like shirts like that. Like,
it was called Grace Court, and then looking at those three T-shirts they had, they were very similar to the Tony Soprano style. So I'm assuming that's the site it was, Grace Court.
Huh?
We'll see Roser walking around with the Deion Sanders shirt on.
No, that's not.
Much was it?
It's like 55.
Yeah, it's not bad. Like, just like Do Not Disturb, where I got that WNBA shirt from. It's the same kind of thing. They got the big print on the front. They're like $55.
NBA players even, he's right about the is it real thing. Because I told y'all about that. Yeah. I've gotten twice.
You got popped?
Twice. One of them was like a pair of pants or something from some. Now what I've had to do is, one of the things I've learned, because I went back and like looked at one of the ones that I bought from that was obviously like just a scam, and I go to like the bottom and I see when the website started.
Yeah.
And if it's 2021, I'm out.
Yeah.
Like, bro, I can't buy your stuff. Like, you just yeah, you really put this website up today. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
2021, I can't do it.
I mean, or you can,
you know what I mean? Or if that's when your company started, or if there's no, like,
it takes you to, like, a GeoCities page or something.
Yeah, there's no, like, about us, you know, tab. Like, there's nothing about your company, nothing. But, dude, by far, I'm telling you, the worst Instagram ad purchase. It's not even close. Bro, if you saw this lint thing. It is literally like, it's almost like a cheese grater. I'm not kidding.
Oh my God.
It's like a handle with this wire thing on it. And if you rub it on your like shirt or your sweater, it's going to rip. It's going to rip the whole damn thing up. It's like if you put a cheese grater on your shirt to get lint off of it.
How much you pay for it?
I don't remember. It was a two-pack. They really got me, boy.
Oh, I'm like, man.
I'm like, oh, man. You know, sometimes I'll get like, you know, I'll see like Charlie's hair on my on my T-shirt or something. Or I'll like have to lint roll. Or like maybe like on the like the ottoman or something, if he goes and lays on there, I'm like, this would be great. I got this thing in the mail. It'll tear anything up. It will. I'm not kidding. It'll like tear your shirt up.
Hey, they'll get you.
They got me.
I do the thing.
They must have seen that at some point I must have like, you know, they know everything about you, but they figured out, you know, this guy's a dog owner. So we're going to get him with this pet hair thing. And they'll be like, you have pet hair on your ottoman? Like, how did you know? I do. Do you have pet hair on your clothes? Yeah. I'm like, looking down at my clothes, and I'm like, I'll be damned.
They heard you yelling about it. That's what they heard you yelling about.
They heard me in the house saying, damn it. Freaking Charlie's hair is all over me, or Charlie's hair is all over the ottoman. And then I go and look, and immediately there's an Instagram ad. Hey, does your dog Charlie leave hair on your
ottoman?
Like, you know what? My dog Charlie does leave hair on my ottoman. And they're like, oh, buy this cheese grater.
Oh, man.
It's going to get your, it's going to rip up all your clothes and your ottoman, too. I'm like, bro, whoever is on the other end of that, you're going to hell.
Exactly.
There's no telling how many people they've scammed.
Yo, I do the cross-check where if it's a website on Instagram, I'll pull the Instagram ad and put it in Safari. Let's see if it comes up in Safari.
Well, that's wise. Because
sometimes the stuff doesn't come up in Safari.
It's just an Instagram company.
I'll do that one to make sure.
The funniest.
Ever since that day you said you got scammed, I've been doing that.
Dude, the funniest, I swear to God, because this happened. You guys remember this. This happened with with Alexis when she was here, and I texted all y'all that night. If I start getting ads this afternoon for like Deion Sanders shirt and stuff like that,
yeah,
I am gonna lose my mind, because back in the day, there was that company that she mentioned on the show. I did not Google it. I did not look it up. Nothing happened. It was like one of those like boxes, like, you know what I mean? Like Freshly's or the, you know, those meal preps.
Yeah.
So she had gotten one. And I didn't look it up or nothing, right? And that afternoon, I got an ad for it. The only time that has ever been mentioned, talked about, anything, was when we were on the show. And that's the time that it, like, for real freaked me out. I'm like, how? How did something that we talked about on the show, like, become an ad to me? How? How?
Yeah.
How is that possible? Did the phone hear it? Is the Google, or is the analytics so deep that even what is talked about on the show becomes my interest? It's like transcribed somewhere into where, like, how?
There's somebody sitting behind a computer right now, like waiting. Like,
how?
Dude, they watch.
Why am I getting an ad for the exact meal prep thing that she talked about that day? It was.
Yeah.
That freaked me out.
They're watching.
That's the first time where I was like, come on. Like, really? This is ridiculous. And it's happened. It's happened a bunch. Like, honestly. Like, things that I have not looked up on my phone.
Yeah.
But I have talked about in real life, all of a sudden become ads to me. And I'm like, I hope y'all get some wire lint roller ads today. If you do, I'm going to die.
I'm going to be mad as hell.
I better not.
I'm going to be mad as hell. Rosa, what's their website again?
Grace Court.
Grace Court?
Grace Court. Just Google Grace Court t-shirts and you'll find
it. Some people in the chat were asking about it. They wanted to. Oh, okay.
Yeah. Two things real quick of Grizzlies note. Desmond Bane apparently said he's going to play in Summer League. So that's cool.
Well, they didn't. Him and Tillman didn't.
Yeah, I know.
Yeah, they
didn't. But Bane played a ton of minutes this year, so it wouldn't just be a shocker if he didn't. But he said he's going to play a few games, so I don't know how many, but he said he's going to play a few games.
That's usually what, I mean, even like, remember that year that we went and Brandon Ingram did? Played in the first game and had like 50 points and then didn't play anymore.
Right. Yeah. And then the other one, it's also Vegas news. Kimball, kid, do you have the picture I sent? Yeah. So Dylan says he won this playing Bure on the plane back, and that's going to pay for his Vegas trip in a couple weeks.
He really said that?
Yeah, that's what he said.
Wait, really?
Yeah, apparently. Yeah. That's what I think it was.
He said I won it playing Bure.
Oh, my God.
On the plane back. Yeah.
Please tell me nobody got punched in the face.
Did Drew Hill have it? I think it was Drew Hill.
Hold on. Rosa, you may be speaking fake news.
Oh, that is hilarious.
Are you Johnny Fake News right now?
Yeah, who posted that, Roser?
Dylan Brooks opened his availability, said his winnings from Bure here paid for his upcoming Vegas trip in a few weeks to relax and recover. Evan Barnes.
Yo, that is funny, bro.
Hilarious.
Dude.
Dylan Brooks is amazing, man. He is a that's funny.
Yeah.
I mean, obviously, it's irresponsible if the reporters did not ask who.
Well, he said it was some West Coast guys. That's what he said. It was West Coast guys. Melton's in there.
Kyle.
He said he's a Pac-12 guy,
Kyle's
too.
Kyle's not a West Coast guy, but he did go to college there.
Yeah, Dylan also bragged he beat a few West Coast guys in Bure. He didn't name names, but when I reminded him he's a Pac-12 guy too, he mentioned how the East Coast Toronto represented by winning out.
All right. Look at Dylan Brooks beating people at Bure.
Yeah,
right. Didn't Tony once play Bure on the plane?
Once?
A couple times?
He did a lot, and then they couldn't do it anymore.
Get the legacy. Hey, some things don't change, man. The legacy lives on. Somebody got punched.
They really are Grizz next gen.
They really are.
All the way down to the card game.
Yep.
Do want to remind everybody, the show is always brought to you by WinBet. Go and download the app, WinBet, and you can get a $500 risk-free first sports bet. You can bet $5, $10, $25, $100, all the way up to $500, and you will get that money put into your account even if you lose the bet. So you can't beat that. WinBet. Everything is first class about the win, both out in Las Vegas and their app, which is now legal in Tennessee. Go bet on the Bucks against Roser's net.
Yeah.
That's what you can do with your fucking bet. Do that. Yeah, they're plus Roser, four
are
tomorrow.
What are you laughing at, Roser?
Oh, yeah. Man. It's so my funny. Nets.
Yeah.
You're going to have your yeah.
Roser's net.
Yeah, you're going to have your net shirt on tomorrow?
Yeah.
Maybe.
Yeah.
Dude, it's a good looking shirt, man. The Basquiat throwback or the Basquiat City is something.
Shut up. Anyway, it should be a good weekend of basketball. It's gonna be weird because it has just been so long since I haven't thought about. All right, what time's the Grizzly game?
Yeah. What are y'all doing this weekend? Well, how are you gonna spend it? How are you gonna spend your first weekend of no Grizzly basketball?
It's supposed to be nice, so I'll play golf.
Looking for old basketball cards.
Yeah, I'll play golf.
Those damn Jordan pennies are somewhere in my place.
Yeah,
I'll
mess with some collectible stuff. I'll probably clean up things that I've been meaning to clean up for the last 3 months. Same. You know what I mean? It's nice outside.
Yeah.
So I'll probably do that. And then, you know, kid stuff.
Wash the car.
But it,
nobody's happier about the season being over than my girlfriend.
Oh, I bet.
Dude, oh, yeah.
She's so excited.
I bet.
So what are you doing with her? Where are y'all going?
We're probably going to – she's cooking dinner tonight. She's cooking asparagus, salmon, and rice tonight. We'll probably go to Carolina Watershed. We got the whole weekend, so we got to – festivities
it's
all
weird,
weekend.
Right?
Yeah, I got to actually find something to do now. I can't be like, yeah, I got a game.
Still hoops to watch, but you don't have to work a game. Yeah, yeah. There's no
I can't be like,
a late
I
night.
Work. She's going to be like, work what?
No, I'll play golf and I'll – That's about it.
Yep.
Hopefully it's going to be beautiful. I think it's supposed to be in the 80s, right?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, so it'll be perfect. All right. Thanks to Devin Walker. Thanks to John Roser across the glass. Thanks
go
to
Kimmel
back in the studio. Everybody have an unbelievable and safe weekend. And thanks to Kyle Anderson and Taylor Jenkins for joining us on the show
yes.
today. We'll talk to you on Monday. Until then, we gone.
That's all I got to give to you, so don't you change your mind. I'm a fool.